out of my God when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds I have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thou all throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, the Lord's holy temple together. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for us being able to be together to worship you, Lord. Lord, there are many times that we've forgotten or not realized how important this hour is. And in many ways, we just take it for granted. Another day at church, another day to come and talk and see different people. But right now, this hour is to be for you, Lord. That all that we do, all that we say and sing and pray, that is to glorify you, Lord. So Lord, help us as we worship you, that your name will be lifted. Not what we have done, but what you have done in each of our lives. Especially what you have done on the cross for us, dying for our sins, shedding your blood in order that our sin may be washed away. Lord, we thank you, and we ask that you forgive us and cleanse us right now. Help us, Lord, as we worship you, that our whole heart will be here, not just part of us, but all of us. That's what you request from us, that we come and sing praises and give thanks and even ask for petition, Lord. Lord, thank you for hearing us and being with us right now. Let's recite the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning. This morning, let's think about the things that God has blessed us with, so we can praise Him and bless Him. Can we do that? Yes? All right.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Let's also continue with our responsive reading. It's entitled, Since Jesus Came Into My Heart. It's taken from Scripture of Psalms, Romans, Ephesians, and 2 Timothy. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. With the heart one believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth one confesses, resulting in salvation. I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to guard what has been entrusted to me until that day.
My lips will shout for joy, and I sing praise to you, because you have redeemed me.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heaven in Christ.
In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding.
Right now, let's all stand to recite our Apostles' Creed. Let's begin.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. Right now, we're going to open this time for anybody out in the congregation to share of anything that's praiseworthy or any prayer requests, and let all we say and do to glorify our Lord Jesus Christ.
But it's been, I'm going to ask my wife, how many years? Between 7 and 8 years, and I've been able, and my wife, to attend church again. This past year, we said goodbye to my mother-in-law, and because we wanted to serve her as a parent, we honored her because she was going through dementia and started Alzheimer's. So she needed dedication and service from her children to be there on Sundays when we could not attend church. We missed this holy place quite a bit. So when my mother-in-law said, I'm going back to see my father in heaven, it gave us a chance to come to church again. So to see these young men and women that when we last saw them, we called them young men and women. Now they're young adults. And we are a little bit older, but now have a chance to come and worship the Lord again. I thank this church for standing by our side in times when we didn't know when we could come back. I thank Reverend Lau for always being there when we needed him. Reverend Fong, always seeing my wife when she works here and to say, when are you coming back? And to our friends that now we can start to come back to church again and actually be in fellowship with you all. I thank you. My wife thanks you.
Good morning. My name is Lucy, and I pray for the Holy Spirit to guide me in my sharing, and may it all be so glorifying to the Lord, because I have a tendency to go all over the place, especially when I went to praise the Lord. 2 weeks ago on Friday, I had an episode with myself, which resulted in my being in an emergency, and I was in the hospital, and I was there for overnight observation. And as it turned out, now I have like another milestone in my life. You're getting older, you get conditioned. I've been healthy all my life, and then now I have a condition. And what I'm trying to say is that through all this, God is so amazingly present. Even as to how I got help to go to be ambulanced to the hospital. And when I was in the hospital, how things went well. And I felt the love and concern of my family in Christ right away. And through it all, even in the days that follows, God never ceased to show me that He is there. And so, and it brought home to me what it means to be in a community like Cornerstone, my fellowship. It's just amazing that when you try your best to always remember God in your life and be faithful to Him, He always amazes you. When things do have to happen, like when you're getting old, you will get things. The body will get there. But at the same time, the Lord is merciful that throughout the old year, there were some funny moments with the paramedics and all that. And I would think about it. And then even when I'm getting poked, I hate needles, but it was okay. And so now I am in a new regimen, and I've learned to accept it. I know the Lord knows better than me what I need, and it's His way of showing and reminding me that He is not ready to call me home yet, and I do have things to do, but I'm waiting, I pray for more attention to Him as to what He would want me still to do in the meantime. But I want to praise Him. I want to praise the Lord. I want you to all to remember that you are never alone. He's always with you, always. It's just a matter of you turning your, eyes upon Him in every instance. And things, there are a lot of things that you won't understand, but He knows, and He knows what's best. So I want to praise God for these 2 weeks. That's amazing. It's amazing. So I praise God in Jesus' name. Amen.
Diane, and I just want to praise God for what He's done for my dad this month. He was diagnosed with skin cancer, and thank God that it wasn't a serious type of cancer. It wasn't anything that would go into his bloodstream or anything. And he went into operation last Wednesday, and it was it was successful. And I just want to just praise God again for the work that He's done for my dad. And right now, my dad is recovering nicely. He doesn't have any more his face was swollen when I went to see him the day after the operation. And now it's gone down, and he's feeling a lot better.
Hi, for those of you who don't know me, I'm Pastor Josh. I just want to talk about last Friday, the high school choir did their musical, Making the Grade. It's a really old musical, but we were able to revamp it, and at the end of the night, there was about 240 people downstairs for refreshments. So a lot of them were new guests, so praise God for just all the people who came, and the choir who did such a great job because they sacrificed a lot to serve God. And so can we give them a hand? Because they worked really hard. And so, A couple people accepted Christ, some people rededicated, and a lot of people are asking questions. So pray for young people. They're really learning to share Christ with their friends and really to love people outside of just our church. So praise God for that.
Hi, I'm Caitlin, and a couple weeks ago, I got the news that my cheer coach passed away, and I was really close to her, and I just want to ask you to pray for me, pray for my cheer friends, and pray for her family, as me personally, I'm still grieving about that right now, and it's really hard. I lost motivation to do a lot of things, and so has my best friend, and we really don't know what's gonna happen next year with our cheer team, so I just ask for all your prayers, and yeah, thank you.
Okay, let's join our hearts in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for how you, in your sovereignty, that everything works out for your good, Lord. And a lot of times we don't know exactly your plan and your will, but you ask us to trust in you, Lord, and be faithful to you, to your words, and to your promises. We thank you for Randy and D.I. to be able to come back to worship with us, and that you know, the mother-in-law is up in heaven with you, Lord, and knowing that and she's in great hands and being really comforted, and that now they can come and fellowship and join in worship and to give you all the glory and praise, Lord. Father, we thank you for the different events, you know, in our lives, and especially right now in Lucy's life, for her to see that she continue trusting in you, continue knowing that you're there everywhere and every day and anywhere, Lord. That she, as she going to a different stage of her life, of health-wise, or her condition, that she can really know that what she's doing is to continue to live for you, Lord, and that whatever opportunity you give her to share your love, to share your gospel, that you still want her, and that she still wants to tell people about you, and that's the one great thing that we have as we're here on this earth, Lord. Father, we and thank you for, you know, Diana and her dad and curing that the skin cancer. And in many ways, we don't even know how it come about, but in many ways, you are in control. You know what you're doing. So, Lord, help us to continue able to share to our loved ones, especially about you, Lord, and how merciful and how graceful and how loving you are. And that we need to accept you into our hearts as our Lord and Savior. We thank you for last Friday as we're able to share your message to the high schoolers, to the different people that came, that your message of the gospel has been brought across, and that those that receive and receive them into your heart, Lord, we ask that you help them to see how important for them to continuing their walk with you, Lord. And so, Lord, we continue praying for the youth groups and that we can continue reaching out to your amazing grace, Lord. Lord, we pray for Caitlin as she's, you know, learning how to take care of the different things that's happening surrounding her life. We ask that you help her to see and open her hearts to you, Lord, and let your Holy Spirit lead her and guide her and motivate her and comfort her in any and every way, Lord, that she can totally rely on you, Lord, and that's all she needs. So continue watching over her and her friends and the family of the coach, Lord, and in many ways we don't understand, we can't even believe it in some ways, but Lord, you know what you're doing, and we just need to trust in you, Lord. So Lord, as we continue to worship you, Lord, that everything we do is to glorify you, Lord. Whether we're singing, whether we're praying, whether we're sharing, that we lift your name up, that everyone around here, everywhere, can hear you and see your glory and see what you have done in each of our lives. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
Let's sing.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the
ushers can come forward to receive the offering. Let's continue meditating upon His word and His psalms.
Let us pray. Dear Father, we just thank You for all the provision You've given to in our lives, Lord. Everything that You provide, and in many ways, we forget. And sometimes we even greedy to want more. Lord, we ask that You help us to realize that what You've given to us is what we need. Lord, help us to learn to give back to You, Lord, of what You have provided for us. As we give to You, we pray that we can be cheerfully giving, knowing that what we're doing is to obeying You and following You. And Lord, as we learn to give, help us to really see that it's part of what You know You want us to do and want us to obey, Lord. Lord, as we continue to worship you, we ask that you help us to really seek after you, Lord, and let your Spirit touch us, teach us, open our hearts to see what we need to change, where we need to, you know, be better. Lord, help us to really listen carefully, Lord. In Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Right now, well, welcome the Mills Choir. They're going to sing a song called Here We Are. Let's all welcome them.
choir and beautiful voices, really. And praise the Lord, today we come to the final sermon of the 1st and 2nd Thessalonians series. And it has been a growing experience for me. It's very difficult to preach in English and very difficult to preach every other week. And I hope you have learned something from the 1st and 2nd Thessalonians series, especially where we treasure the Bible is very important to us in our lives and also very relevant in our lives as well. And today's title is Final Judgment, as it is the final sermon in this series. Let's take a look at the passage. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, 1 through 12. Paul, Silas, and Timothy to the church of Thessalonians in God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace and peace to you from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We ought always to thank God for you, brothers, and rightly so, because your faith is growing more and more, and the love every one of you has for each other is increasing. Therefore, among God's churches, we boast about your perseverance and faith in all the persecutions and trials you are enduring. All this is evident that God's judgment is right, and as a result, you will be counted worthy of the kingdom of God, for which you are suffering. God is just. He will pay back trouble to those who trouble you, and give relief to you who are troubled, and to us as well. This will happen when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven in blazing fire with his powerful angels. He will punish those who do not know God and do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will be punished with everlasting destruction and shut out from the presence of the Lord and from the majesty of his power. On the day he comes to be glorified in his holy people and to be marveled at among all those who have believed. This includes you because you believed it, our testimony to you. With this in mind, we constantly pray for you that our God may count you worthy of his calling and that his power, he may fulfill every good purpose of yours and every act prompted by your faith. We pray this so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our Lord, of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, in the book of 1 Thessalonians that Paul wrote, his first book in the New Testament to the church in Thessalonica, if you still remember, he talked about death, he talked about the second coming of Jesus Christ, and at the end of 1 Thessalonians, he gave three imperatives to the Christians there. He said, okay, if we're going to live in this world, we have to do three things that can carry us through. The three things are, first, rejoice always. And then, pray unceasingly. And then, number three, give thanks in everything. Everything means everything. Good things, bad things, you know. And after 5 months, Paul wrote the second book to the Thessalonians, and he's telling us, you know, how to prepare ourselves for the judgment day. Now, we all know that we will die, you know, one day, okay? This is what is also mentioned in the Bible, you know, Hebrew chapter 9, verse 27. You know, we are all appointed to die one day or once, but there's the second part of this verse of the Bible, and then to face judgment. And judgment day is a very, you know, important and is a reality. And after 5 months, and Paul wrote this book to the Christians in Thessalonica, and he said, okay, we have to prepare ourselves for this judgment day. And there are three things we have to do. We have to give praise, give thanksgiving. We have to preserve ourselves. And also, we have to have a purpose in life. Now, let's take a look, Paul, you know, what he's talking about. Okay. We ought always to thank God for you, brothers and sisters. And because your faith is growing more and more, and the love every one of you has for each other is increasing. Now, there are two words here, very important Greek words, that people at that time, you know, they understood. These were the two words always used to describe it is used by the farmers, okay? It is for growing plants. And now the first one, the first word is grow, means, you know, the plants growing. Now, I don't know if you have a backyard, okay? Right now we're in a drought, so we don't grow a lot of things, okay? I put rocks in my backyard, so I don't, you know, it's not about drought, it's about laziness, okay? I don't want to mow my lawn anymore. But still, I plant something in my, you know, the side planters. And I still remember I bought a 2-inch fig tree, okay, when I first came to the States last year. And now it's already more than 2 feet. And I'm happy, you know, it's growing. When you look at it, you know, growing inch by inch every day, and you're happy about it. Now, this word describes the farmers when they look at the crops, okay, growing, you know, growing and growing, and you feel happy about it. And the second word is increasing, okay. It's a word describing the water, the irrigation water coming into the field, okay. When a farmer looks at the water, like the California people now look at rain, you know, and we're happy because, you know, the water is coming into the field and irrigating, you know, all our plants. And why I point out these two words? Because these two words are not just a one-time happening words, okay? These are the two participles. And in Greek, if you still remember, participles mean it's ongoing. It's not a one-time event or one-time incident. It's something that keeps going, okay? This is a very important truth to our Christian lives that Paul is trying to convey, to tell us. Faith and love is not a one-time incident that we get when we accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior at the moment. You know, there are some Christians that they don't understand this, okay? They think, okay, I don't have love, I don't have faith, okay, so if I accept Jesus Christ as my Savior, at that moment, okay, I will have a quick fix in life. Okay, I'm going to have faith and love, you know, all the faith and all the love I have. But after they accepted Jesus, they find out, okay, it's not true. Okay, then they give up. Or some Christians, they have a wrong idea about growing and increasing love and faith. They think when you go to a meeting and you get laid, you know, hand on your head, and then suddenly you will be zapped by the Holy Spirit and you will suddenly have faith and love. And then you will go out, you know, from the auditorium, and then you will tell people, I have all the love I have right now, okay? I'm going to love everybody in the world. Or I'm going to have faith, you know, I have the complete faith. So I'm going to go out and face everything in faith, okay? This is not true. Paul said faith and love, they have to be growing and increasing all the time. And it's an ongoing process, okay? It's not a one-time event. And sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes, God has a very unique growing and increasing formula in our lives. And let's take a look. Paul is saying the same thing to the Thessalonians. He said, therefore, okay, your love and your faith is growing and is increasing. Therefore, amongst God's churches, we boast about your perseverance and faith. Why? Why they're growing? In all the persecutions and trials you are enduring. You know, sometimes God is so funny. When he wants you to learn something, he always wants to put you in situations that is exactly the opposite. You know, he is always using negative things to teach us positive, you know, meaning. And this is how, you know, sometimes how he works in our lives. when we grow, when we increase in our love and faith. No, he likes to do things like that because when we face exactly the opposite, it's the time for us to learn what he wants us to learn. About, you know, perseverance. You can never learn and grow in perseverance when you sit down in an air-conditioned home on your, you know, $1,000 sofa, you know, open a bag of Lay's chips and turn on the TV and watch how the Warriors beat, you know, Pelicans, you know. And you said, oh, I got all the perseverance in life, okay? And brothers and sisters, you are not going to have to grow your faith, okay, if you go on, you know, a cruise and look at the sunset at the Caribbeans and enjoy, you know, all the seafood buffet you can have, you know, like Pastor Poon in the Cantonese congregation. Yeah, he just came back, you know, from the cruises. And you look at the ocean and look at the beautiful, you know, sunset, and you say, oh, I got faith, Lord. I got faith. And brothers and sisters, if you want to grow in faith, get invited by Jesus Christ on a boat in the Sea of Galilee. And then you face the storm and the waves. And you yell to Jesus, oh, we are going to die. And Jesus seems to be sleeping and doing nothing. And then Jesus woke up and say, ye men of little faith. And you see how God works his miracles, and then your faith will grow. And brothers and sisters, this is how God works in our lives and also in the lives of, you know, the Thessalonians. And this is very important because sometimes our focus, our faith, you know, we will only focus on the things that's around us. Our joy depends on the happening. You know, I said that many times that, you know, happy derives from the word happening. Okay, when something happens around you, you know, it dictates, you know, your joy and your happiness. But joy to us Christians, we should have a target. And a target is not the things around us. The target should be on God. And this is why, you know, Satan got, you know, said to God, you know, if you take away things, you know, from Job, okay, then, you know, he's going to leave you because he's so blessed, you know, by the surroundings, you know, by all the blessings you gave him. And think about that. If God is going to take away things that we enjoy and make us easy, make us comfortable, and take us away from our comfort zone to something challenging, to something that's negative or something that's totally opposite to what we want to learn. That means pain. That means suffering. Maybe we'll learn how to grow in love and faith. As I've said many times, we learn to love people by placing ourselves in those unlovable people, okay, among them. Then you learn how to love, okay? And this is a formula that, you know, we have to learn through the Bible, because the Bible always tells us, if you want to grow, usually growth involves some kind of loss. And loss involves some kind of change. But change will bring growth to you in love and in faith and in perseverance. But we have to accept this formula. I still remember last year, I sent my young kid, her name is Kay, okay? The first time she left home to go to short-term mission, okay, when she was 14 years old. She went to Cambodia last year. And I was so moved. And when I look back, you know, when she grew up, when she was 1 year old, she never liked to walk, because every time she walked, she would trip and fell and she would cry and you know, she would hurt her knees and bleeding and things like that. And And so she never liked to walk. She liked me, you know, holding her up. But if I'm going to protect her and hold her all the time and never let her fall and get hurt, then she would never learn how to walk. And 2 years ago, my elder kid, okay, she lost her iPhone in the classroom because she thought, okay, everybody should be nice in the class, okay? So I put my iPhone on my desk, okay, and then I go out, you know, to the restroom, and then I come back, it should always be there, okay? And she lost it. And now she learned a hard lesson, and she learned how to protect her phone, okay? Now she's carrying it all the time, you know, even going to the restroom for 1 or 2 minutes. And every time when you know, learn something, you need to change, and the change involves some kind of loss, and the loss will bring you experience in growth. So I always tell people that, you know, when my two kids, you know, when they learn to grow and when they learn to change, and but every time the loss is on me, you know, yeah, I have to pay for the new iPhone, you know, and you know, we learned it this way, you know. Now, not every pain will lead to growth, but if you want to grow, you must be ready to accept changes. And this is what happened. This is not what is happening to my church in Hong Kong. You know, I've served there for 26 years, and I've told my church people, you know, they have to face a change that if I'm not there, the church will still grow, you know. We will still keep on the mission that Jesus Christ has given us. And that may be a loss, okay, to them, you know, after I leave. But the loss will bring changes, and the changes will bring growth to them. And Paul said to the Thessalonians, he said, okay, because of your persecutions and trials, you have been growing in faith and growing, increasing in love. Okay, so we have to learn to have perseverance. Now, let's take a look at Paul. This is very important, okay? Paul said, all this is evidence that God's judgment is right and God is just. Wait a minute, okay, brothers and sisters. You said, Pastor Ting, I don't feel good about this, you know, two verses, okay? You said God is right? You know, look at what happened, you know, 2 days ago in Nepal, you know, earthquake. And you said God is just? Are you kidding? You know, take a look at all the injustice things that's happening in this world. You know, when you take a look at on TV, when the news, you know, telling us how the ISIS, you know, killing the Ethiopian Christians and the Egyptian Christians, you know, beheaded on the, you know, on the beach. And you said God is just? Are you kidding me? I think a lot of Christians, we are trying to think, you know, if God is just, why he let so many sufferings, you know, so many bad things happen to good people in this world. And so Paul today is going to give us a solution. Now Paul said, okay, let's come. I'm going to bring you to see a movie. This is a good movie, okay? But I'm not going to let you see the movie from the beginning. I want to let you see the movie at the end first, okay? You see the ending, and then we keep watching the movie from the beginning. Like, have you done something like that? I don't know if you have done something like that. Okay, I always like to do things because I don't have time. I like sports, okay, but I don't have time to sit there and, you know, watch the Giants game for 4 and 5 hours, you know. No way, you know. Sometimes I would just, you know, record them, you know, in the past and then or watch replay. Because I know the result already, okay? If the Giants lost, okay, forget it. I'm not going to watch, okay? Yeah, if the Giants won, then I would, you know, just keep on watching. I still remember, you know, last year I was in Hong Kong, okay, watching the World Series in a hotel room, okay? And a game number 4. If you still remember, okay, the final result, how many of you watched game 4? I mean the World Series, so some of you, right? Game 4, it was 11-4, okay, the Giants won. In the fourth inning, the Royals stole a base, and the umpire said he was safe, okay. And when I was watching, I said, how could that be, okay? How could that be safe? But you know, he stole a base and then they scored, you know, and then the score was 4-1, you know, Royals leading. But because I knew the result already, it was 11-4. So no matter, you know, how the Royals fans cheering and the players, they were just excited, you know, give all high fives and you know, joyful and everything. You know, I was laying, you know, sitting on my sofa and then in the hotel room, and I said, okay, you know, the one who laughs last, laughs best, right? And, you know, just cheer up, you know, yeah. Have all the joy you can have, you know, because the Giants is going to win. And brothers and sisters, I'm saying this illustration is to tell you what Paul is trying to say to us, okay? When you look at the concentration camp in the Second World War, where 6 million Jews were massacred, you would not be happy about that, right? But if you already know Hitler, he was going to kill himself in an underground bunker with his wife. And he committed suicide. And the Nazi Germany is going to be conquered by the Allied forces. And the Jews, they are going to have their own nation in 1948. And when you look back, of course, when you see people being killed, you will not be happy. But there's one thing you will have. That is hope. When you look at the Royals players, you know, joyfully, you know, giving high fives, you know, there's one thing you would have. Hope, okay? Because you know what will happen at the end. Now, Paul is reminding us, okay, when we look at all the trials and sufferings and persecutions and pain in this world, okay, it seems to have no answers at all. But always look to the ending of human history. And when we know the end, and then we come back and continue our human history, and we know that, okay, God is just and He is right at the end. And this brings us a very important word in our Christian life, that is H-O-P-E, hope. That is hope. And God said, well, when you look at these things, take a look at the ending, and we know the conclusion, what will happen. Okay, that will be the judgment day. This will happen when the Lord is revealed from heaven in blazing fire and His powerful angels. On that day, He comes to be glorified in His holy people and be marveled at among all those who have believed it. This includes you because you believed it, our testimony to you. And Paul said, when will be the judgment day? Okay, that will be the day that Jesus Christ is coming back. God is slow to anger. But the Bible never tells us God never gets angry. One day He will come not as a savior, but as a judge. When today, when we look at, there are so many unjust and injustice and things seems not right, and bad things always happen to good people. And and we are discouraged. But Paul said one day, God is going to come, and Jesus is going to come and put everything back to right, okay? And we have to believe in that. There will be one day, payday, someday. And who is going to, you know, to be punished? Those persecuting us and also those rejecting Jesus. Remember, Jesus said in the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verse 36, he who believes in the Son will have eternal life. But he who does not believe in the Son will not get life. But the wrath of God always remains in him. And when you look at this verse, verse number 8, I feel so burdened, brothers and sisters. Now, we have read the book about heaven is real. But let me tell you from the Bible that hell is also real. And when we take a look at the end of those people who reject Jesus, and my heart is always burdened, because the ending is very horrifying and very damning, really. Take a look, what will happen to them? Okay, they will be punished, A. B, they will face everlasting destruction. And C, they will be shut out from the presence of the Lord and from the majesty of his power. You know, aren't these things very damning, brothers and sisters? And we think deeper, okay? We can escape this kind of punishment and judgment all because we are willing to accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And we can escape all these. But think about those people that we know or even we don't know. If they're not a Christian, one day they are going to face this. And this is a very important message to us Christians, okay? We are on a mission here, okay? We don't just come here and enjoy life, okay? We come here because God has called us to help the other people to escape this punishment. And this is our mission on earth, brothers and sisters. And Paul is reminding us the reality of hell and the reality of punishment in the judgment day. When he comes, he will be the angry judge who is going to judge those he has promised to judge. And what should we do? And Paul said, so on earth, we have to have a purpose in life. Paul said three things very fast. Testify his call. With this in mind, we constantly pray for you that our God may count you worthy of his calling. We're saved to be on a mission. We just don't come here and then the pastors don't just tell you, go and you are dismissed. We're telling you, go, you are sent. Away from this church, into your family, into your place, and to share your testimony. Testify his call, and then magnify his power. And your life, you know, is a life of showing people about the faith of Jesus Christ. Keep on increasing and keep on growing in love and in faith and demonstrate to other people that you are Christians. You are believers in the true God, a living God. Testify his call, magnify his power, and also glorify his name. We pray that so the name of our Lord Jesus Christ may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. I have a friend in Hong Kong who is a medical oncologist. You know, he works in a cancer ward of a hospital. And he set up a fellowship for those people. And because a lot of them, when they go to a hospital, they are facing terminal, you know, cancer illness. And many of them, you know, would die in the hospital. And my friend, he said, I don't know why we Christians, we are not very serious and not very urgent in sharing the gospel to other people, because life and death to us seems so far away. And he said, when I look at the patients every day, I don't know if they can live tomorrow. Maybe today is the only chance I can share the gospel to them. It's about life and death. And I know that after they die, if they are not a Christian, they will face eternal destruction, which is very scary. So this is my mission, he said, to share the gospel while I can. And brothers and sisters, this is something I want to encourage you today. You share, not because you're scared, or you don't want to, you know, you don't want to scare people, you know, you're going to hell, you know, yeah, so you have to believe in Jesus. But this is real, you know, this responsible sharing, because, you know, let me share with you. 3 years ago, you know, I discovered I have high blood pressure, okay? So I went to see the doctor, and the doctor told me I have to take pills, I have to take, you know, medication, or else I will get a stroke, okay? So I began taking the medication, and now I'm okay. But I never complained to the doctor and say, oh, you're trying to scare me, you know? You know, you tried to scare me with death. No, I think he's a responsible doctor because he shared with me the consequences of not taking medication. And we Christians, we have to find a way to share to other people that heaven is real, but hell is also real. And this is a complete gospel we have to share to those who are not yet Christians. And Paul, before he died, okay, he said this, and of this gospel I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher. This is why I'm suffering as I am, yet I'm not ashamed, because I know whom I have believed in, and am convinced that he's able to guard what I have entrusted to him for that day. We will face that day one day. And are you ready to face that day? And are your loved ones ready to face that day? May the message encourage us to share our faith courageously, boldly, and frequently. Let's pray together. Dearest Father, I thank you for helping us to know that your promises in the Bible never fail. Lord, you know that in this congregation, we have people facing sufferings and trials and pain, whether they are physically, emotionally, or spiritually. But Lord, we ask you to give hope to us. When we look at the end, we know that you are still a just and right God. And you are our God, Lord. And apart from you, we have no good things. We pray that, Lord, you will work everything, good things and bad things together for the good of us, so we can experience the faith and love that you want us to increase and to grow. And as we grow, we can have stories to tell other people that you are the loving and you are the living God that give everybody hope. We pray all this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
I hope that the message has really encouraged you, and I hope that God is speaking to you. And if this is something that's really in your heart and you haven't accepted Christ yet, please talk to a believer. If you're watching online, please talk to a believer and ask how you can accept Christ. Bond of love.
We are one in the bond of love. We are one.
we thank you for speaking to us. Lord, I pray that we can continue to remember the urgency, the reality of your judgment. Lord, we thank you for your love. We thank you that you have saved us. We pray that we can continue in faith and in your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Mr. Barry.
This is the time in our worship when we welcome our guests. So if you've brought a guest today, please stand and introduce them to us. Thank you.
Okay. Welcome, all of you. We'd like to invite our youth ushers and hostesses to come and meet after worship right here on the side. Next slide. Today, we're going to have a special meeting for all the adults who can help out in building the next generation in our church. Okay, we're going to have a special quickie meeting to help basically the young people of our church. So if you would come to the cafetorium at 12:30, we'll give you a quick review, and we have a plan. We have a project that we're going to introduce to everybody. All right, today, right after worship in the cafetorium. Next slide. Outside, we have some flyers, some yellow flyers about our May seminars, which will start this Friday. This Friday. This Friday. This Friday. Okay. This Friday. All right, so fill out your form and get the right seminar for this Friday. All right, this Friday. Next week, we're having our membership, our annual membership. Those who are members, please make sure you come. If you cannot make it, fill out a form in regards to your membership for this year. I'm having a quick class this afternoon at 1:45 to 3:45 for those who want to become a member. It's we're going to go through all the things that a church member needs to know. All right, so 1:45 to 3:45. We have three candidates right now, and we'll get ready for next week. Next slide. On our school side, item number 6 in your bulletin, okay, if you want more information, we're supporting our Cornerstone Academy school. If you go to any of these places, Targets, Amazon, Safeway, Lucky, Office Depot, read item number 6 on how to support that. Your purchases would help support Cornerstone Academy. All right. Next slide. Church camp is coming up. Okay, we have our youth camp, we have our college adult camp, family camp. If you are able to come, please come, because there will come a time that you will not be able to come. All right, you're sick in the hospital, your boss won't let you out, your parents are sick, your children are sick, you have no more money, your house burns down. Okay, all kind of reasons why people can't come to camp. Can't come to camp, okay? So if you are able, if you can get off of work, if you get off for those, for adult camp those 3 days, or for youth camp those 7 days, go, right? Don't decide, okay? God wants you to go to spend time, meditate on his word, hang with his people, and just spend time with God, okay? So do register if you can. If you can't, then we asked you to help drive, okay? If you can't come to camp, drive, especially, was it the 7th and the 13th, all right? Offer to drive, okay? Pay for your own gas, and just don't listen to all the noise in the back seat and all that kind of stuff. Just drive people down so they can, you know, especially going to Watsonville for the youth camp, okay? So you can help out by driving. Also, you can help out by donating, all right? If you have to work, you have to have summer school, you have whatever it is, donate some money to help somebody. We've had about a dozen people already ask for scholarship just for the young adult college family camp, okay? So people going through hard times, all right? And especially for youth camp, all right? A lot of young people, they don't have the bucks, all right? So talk to the people outside, talk to Bubbles, talk to me, and, you know, donate some money to help these campers get to camp, because we have a great program. We have some great speakers, okay? Adult camp, we have a this coach named Jerry Mann who's coming, all right? So he's a very, well, we'll tell you about that later, okay? But today, we'd like you to register, come to camp, or volunteer to drive, or donate some money, okay? So do everything. If you can go through all three, that's great, all right? So Next. This is one of our camps.
Here in this worn and weary land, where many a dream has died.
This is our camp theme, Thrive.
Like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to know.
To thrive, okay? And that's the emphasis. We'll be training everybody and telling everybody how to thrive in their life and in their relationship with God and everything. Okay? Next slide. Today is early registration deadline, okay? It's $290 for the young adult, for the college young adult, family conference. So if you get it in today, or you know, if you have cash, give it to me. I'll write you a check or something like that. All right. Well, we want everybody to sign up as if you know that you can come to camp, sign up for it. Okay. If you think you might be able to come to camp, sign up for it anyway. All right. I think that should do it. After worship, please do greet the people to your left and right and behind you. Greet them some way, shake their hands, especially, you know, D.I. and Randy are coming more regularly. Mary and his family's here, and Larry's here, and just all kind of people here. If you have not met them, please meet some of the people here in our congregation. Don't just escape, all right? All right, let's stand and sing our doxology.
Praise God from
and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Share the gospel confidently, boldly, and frequently. Shake hands with three people. Greet three people around you. Don't be shy. Be bold. Craig, you got three people?